Have you ever been associated in any way with any illegal activity?
Huh? I gambled.
Tony Accardo, known as Joe Batters, was a notorious figure in the world of organized crime. Born in Chicago in 1906, he rose through the ranks of the Chicago outfit, eventually becoming the day-to-day boss in 1947. Despite being suspected of involvement in numerous murders, Accardo was never convicted of any serious crimes. He stepped down as boss in 1957, becoming the outfit's consigliere. He died on May 22, 1992, at the age of 86, having overseen decades of violence and corruption in the city. His legacy remains a dark stain on the history of Chicago. Accardo, the son of a shoemaker, was born Antonio Leonardo Accardo in 1906 in Chicago's Little Italy. He dropped out of school in the sixth grade and earned his first arrest at the age of 15. In later years, Accardo denied being Capone's chauffeur bodyguard or even that he inherited his criminal empire. Accardo was described by an associate as having more brains before breakfast than Al Capone had all day. However, Vincenzo DeMora, known as Machine Gun Jack McGurn, recruited him into the Capone mob. He began his criminal career as a member of the Circus Cafe Gang, which was created by Missourian John Screwy Moore, also known as Claude Maddox. During the late 1920s, the Circus Cafe Gang was a group of young toughs who frequented the Circus Cafe at 1857 West North Avenue. The Circus Cafe Gang and another near Northwest Side Gang, the Guilfoyle Gang, were Capone's syndicate subsidiaries that operated as counterforces to the Dean O'Banion Gang. The 1929 St. Valentine's Day Massacre is thought to have been plotted in the Circus Cafe. William Romer, a retired FBI agent, believed Accardo was the triggerman in the massacre because he was observed with a machine gun in the lobby of Capone's headquarters shortly after the shootings. When Capone was imprisoned for a short period in 1929, he appointed a triumvirate to reign in his place, Jake Guzik over administration, Frank Nitti over operations, and Accardo over enforcement. Machine Gun Jack McGurn, Tough Tony Capizio, Sam Golfbag Hunt, Screwy John Moore, and Jimmy Belcastro, the King of the Bombers, were all under Accardo's command. Accardo's reputation soared when Capone was convicted of tax evasion and sentenced to 11 years in prison in 1932. When Nitti committed suicide rather than go to prison in 1943, Accardo became the mob's recognized leader. Accardo shared power with his good friend Paul Ricca over the years, one of the few underworld connections that never resulted in a double cross. On December 30, 1943, Ricca was convicted of extortion and sentenced to 10 years. When Ricca was prohibited from interacting with the mob as a condition of his parole 3 years later, Accardo took over as the outfit's boss. In reality, he shared control with Ricca, who stayed in the background as a senior consultant. Accardo and Ricca expanded Chicago's power well beyond what Al Capone was willing to do. Accardo, more than any other guy, asserted Chicago's influence as far west and south as California, Arizona, Colorado, Texas, and Nevada. The eastern mobs made no objection, requesting only that they be granted rights to Nevada and California. In exchange, Chicago received lucrative rewards in Florida, Cuba, and the Bahamas. Accardo and Ricca stressed maintaining a low profile and letting more prominent individuals, like Sam Giancana, draw attention instead. Due to heat from the IRS, Accardo officially abdicated his position to Giancana after 1957. Accardo then resigned from overseeing the outfit's daily operations and took on the role of consigliere, although he retained significant power and insisted on being treated with the utmost respect. Giancana still needed Accardo and Ricca's approval for significant transactions, such as murders. Giancana eventually grew too hot, and Accardo and Ricca were forced to return to active leadership in the mid-1960s. Many members of the outfit also believed Giancana was getting too much attention from the FBI, which was constantly tailing his automobile around the Chicago region. Accardo and Ricker replaced Giancana with Joe Iuppa in 1966 after he spent a year in jail on federal contempt of court charges. Paul Ricker passed away in 1972, making Accardo the outfit's ultimate leader. When Sam Giancana was slain in 1975, it was clear that it could only have happened with Accardo's permission. However, a number of mobsters would tell the press that the Giancana assassination was a CIA operation to keep him from divulging specifics of the agency's weird and immature Fidel Castro assassination scheme. On January 9, 1978, Accardo, while in Palm Springs, was contacted and informed that his house had been burglarized. Accardo called his protege, Jackie Cerrone, the guy he had elevated into the spot of mob boss. The first body found, on January 20, 1978, was that of Bernie Ryan, whose throat had been slashed from ear to ear and had been shot four times. Steven Garcia's was found on February 2nd, his throat slashed and stabbed multiple times. 2 days later, agents found Vincent Moretti and Donald Swanson, a.k.a. Donald Reno. Their bodies were in the backseat of Swanson's Cadillac in the parking lot of a restaurant. On February 20th, police discovered the body of John Mandel. He was tortured and his throat slashed. On April 14th, 42-year-old Johnny McDonald was found, throat slashed, shot in the head and neck. On April 26th, another well-known Chicago area burglar, Bobby Hertogs, was found in the trunk of a car with his throat slashed and shot multiple times. A federal grand jury in the Northern District of Illinois held hearings on the situation in September. Accardo was the first witness. The houseman who called Accardo about the crime, Michael Volpe, was then subpoenaed. Volpe vanished 5 days after his grand jury hearing on October 5th and was never seen again. On Friday, November 10th, 1978, more than a dozen FBI agents executed a search warrant on the home of Accardo. They found a walk-in safe from which they confiscated $275,000, but were later forced under court order to return. John Borsellino's body was discovered in a farmer's field near the Cookwell County boundary on May 22, 1979. He'd been shot multiple times. Jerry Caruziello was found dead in an apartment complex in suburban Addison, shot 7 times in the back. The FBI ultimately discovered that Borsellino and Caruziello were the mob hitmen responsible in the murders of the 7 burglars. Not 10, but 11 people had been executed in direct relation to Accardo's home at 1407 North Ashland in River Forest. The contractor in the building of this home in 1963 was a man named Sam Panvino, who used the professional name of Van Corbin. After FBI agent Romer contacted Corbin for blueprints and architectural drawings for the house, needed for installing microphones and other listening devices into the home, Corbin was shot and killed by 2 men outside the Country Club Motel at 8303 North Avenue in Melrose Park, a western suburb of Chicago, on July 20, 1966. The authorities made numerous attempts to capture and bring down Accardo. Years of man hours, tons of resources, a hidden mic in his headquarters, several confrontations, scores of surveillances, 2 or 3 indictments, and even a conviction were not enough to bring him down. Accardo boasted till his death that he had never spent a night in jail. Accardo spent his latter years with his daughter and son-in-law in Barrington Hills, Illinois. Anthony Accardo died on May 22, 1992, from respiratory and cardiac problems at the age of 86.